Hi, I'm Chris from TravelTime, and today I'm going to show you around one of our new developer playgrounds. These new playgrounds provide a really simple way to learn how the different endpoints of the TravelTime API work, including how the various parameters operate and what the request and response bodies look like. Today we'll be taking a look at our Isochrone playground, which provides access to the time map endpoint of the TravelTime API. This is used for creating catchment areas based on a maximum journey time, and this is possible for any mode of transport. So let's jump in and take a look at the playground. So first off, just to outline the different areas that you can see on the screen. So we have a map in the middle that already has an isochrone displayed on it. We have some mandatory fields up at the top. We have some optional advanced parameters down the bottom that we can toggle on and off. And then over on the right hand side, we have the request body and the response. We can copy both of these to the clipboard. And as we'll see as we go through this, this request and response bodies update in real time as we update any of the parameters. The final thing to note is we have a request processed time down here that will show the response time of the API whenever we send a new request by updating any of the parameters. So let's have a look at how it actually works. The simplest way to generate a new request is just to drag and drop the marker. When we let go of it, we get a new request body. The request gets sent to the API and we get a new response back. So just to drag and drop again, as I release it, the only thing changing in the request is the lat-long coordinates that represent this marker, and then we get a different response back. You can also see that every time we do it, we get a different response time. Let's now have a look at the mandatory parameters. So rather than dragging and dropping the marker, we can also type an address in the location bar. What this does is use actually a different endpoint of the TravelTime API called the geocoder, which will turn that address into lat-long coordinates and also suggest to us what address it thinks we're talking about. So if I select that, we can see the marker has now moved to this location and the coordinates have been updated and a new request has been sent and a new response received from the API. We can also change the travel time. Say I wanted to do 59 minutes or right down to 15 minutes. And each time I change this value, a new request is sent to the API. In this application, we've limited this to 1 hour, but when using the TravelTime API properly, you can go up to 4 hours as your travel time. We can also choose whether we want an arrival or a departure search. So this is an area of locations that I can set off from to arrive at this destination. If I select departure, it'll be locations that I can get to setting off from this location. We can also choose a time and a date. So particularly for public transport, changing this time, say to 2 a.m. versus midday, you can see the shapes of the public transport area change based on the actual public transport timetables. And finally, we can change the mode of transport. So we could look at a driving area, for example, or maybe just a walking area. And these are the only mandatory fields that we need to use when using the time map endpoint of the API. So I'm just going to go back to a central London location, choose public transport, and have a slightly longer travel time, 45 minutes. Now we're going to look at the advanced settings. So these are all optional fields that don't need to be included in a request, but let you kind of fine tune the analysis that you might want to do. So when I toggle this on, as you can see, the request body has now been updated to include lots more parameters. And these all correspond to these advanced settings that we can configure over here. So we won't walk through all of these. If you want to understand what they all mean, you can hover over them, and they also all have a link to the relevant API documentation where you can learn exactly what that parameter means. But for example, this walking time parameter is in a public transport journey. How long do you let someone walk from where they set off to the first public transport stop or station? And then again, at the other end of the journey, how long do you let them walk from the final stop or station to their destination? And we can simply go in and either set the time in seconds or pick a sort of common value from the list. Say I wanted to allow someone to walk for 30 minutes or only 3 minutes. And we can see each time I change this value, the value will change in the actual request body and the shape will obviously change as well. Let's put this back up to say 15 minutes. Another one that's worth highlighting is this level of detail. So if I go and do a walking area with a really low travel time, let's do 5 minutes. What this level of detail parameter lets us do is configure how granular the edge of the isochrone is. So if we select our lowest setting, you can see the edge is slightly less detailed. And this might be a benefit if you're worried about the size of the response coming back, because this will include fewer lat-long coordinates that trace out the edge of that shape. But if we want a really detailed shape, we could go up to the highest setting, and we now get a much more granular edge to this isochrone, which might be important, particularly for small travel times where the edge of it needs to be super detailed. Let's go back to a public transport journey and do 45 minutes. The other one I wanted to highlight is this range feature. And what the range does is it converts an arrival time or a departure time to a departure window or arrival window. So say we want to arrive at 9 a.m. With range disabled, i.e. false, this is the catchment area for 45-minute public transport journeys that arrive at 9 a.m. But if we want to set a more general arrival time of at some point between, say, 8 a.m. and 9 a.m., we can do that by turning on range. So if we set this to true with a width of 3,600 seconds, which represents an hour, what this does is it sets an arrival window of 9 a.m. and an hour before it. So journeys that arrive at any point between 8 a.m. and 9 a.m. And we can see that by having range enabled, we get a much larger isochrone because there's more possible journeys that arrive within that 1 hour window compared to range disabled journeys that only arrive at 9 a.m. If I just toggle off the advanced settings, I'm going to go back to a driving area. The final thing to show is how to add multiple isochrones. So if we click this little plus icon over on the left-hand side, we get the option to add up to 4 more isochrones. And there's a couple of ways we can do this. First off, we can just hit the little plus. It adds a new marker over the top of the original one, and then we can simply drag this away and start creating multiple shapes. Once we have these multiple shapes, we can also choose whether to create a union and an intersection of them. So if I select union, the API will now return any area that is reachable from either of these locations. If I switch to intersection, the API will return an area that is reachable from both of those locations. And it's worth noting that this is functionality in the API. The API is not returning to Isochrones, and this application is finding the intersection. The API itself is returning the intersection. The other way we can add multiple isochrones is to add more addresses. If I type another postcode in, I can get another isochrone added to the map, again, using the TravelTime geocoder to locate that address. And again, once it's been added, I can drag it around. And as mentioned, we can add up to 5 of these. So I could add another one over here. And again, I can create a union or an intersection. So let's find the area that's reachable from all 3 of these locations. And that is the Isochrone Playground. If you want to play around with it yourself, it's available at the URL playground.traveltime.com/isochrones. And you can also download a free API key if you want to start playing around with the API and building your own applications. Thanks for listening.